Good morning. If you have any announcements, you may come forward and share your announcements. I do have one announcement to share. There will be an Indian Taco Dinner fundraiser on April 1st at the Chickahominy Tribal Center. Time is 3 to 6 p.m. Cost is $10 per Indian taco, $3 per fry bread only. This is sponsored by Nyla Brand, the junior class president of Charles City High School. This is to benefit the junior and senior prom. Contact Nyla or Suzanne Brown to pre-order. Any other announcements this morning?
Good morning. Good to see you today. Thank you for being here. I just wanted to make the announcement about Tuesday night. We didn't have our Bible study last Tuesday because of the deacons meeting, but we will have it this coming Sundays. This coming Tuesday. Thank you.
All right. Samantha had reached out to me. She helps head up the Parks and Rec. She wanted me to announce Saturday, April 1st at 10 a.m., there is a kids' Easter egg hunt at Harrison Park. So April 1st, 10 a.m., Harrison Park, an Easter egg hunt. Just bring a bag. And then Wednesday, April 5th, ages 12 to 17, is going to be a teen flashlight Easter egg hunt. So be in the evening. Bring a bag and a flashlight if you are the ages of 12 to 17. And that will be at the Social Center in Charles City. So if you have any questions, you can ask me or you can contact Samantha on Facebook. And that is it.
We may have a minute to give everyone time to come in and get settled. So while we are waiting, let's just settle ourselves and prepare to encounter Jesus today. Good morning. Our call to worship will be 10,000 Reasons, if you can all stand. Thank you for the opportunity to come worship you. We thank you that we can come in the open. We do not have to gather in secret, and we can just proclaim you as Lord and Savior. We come seeking you today. We seek the visitation of the Holy Spirit. I pray, Lord, that whoever comes in here with a need, you will meet that need today. I pray that when they leave, they will know that they have encountered you and they will carry you back into this world. Again, we just thank you for the opportunity to come, praise, worship, and fellowship together. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Good morning. I am Lisa Christian Brown, a deacon at Samaria, and I extend to you welcome on behalf of Samaria. Psalms 133 states, "Behold, and how good it is, and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity." We welcome you to today's worship service, whether you're here or in the parking lot, or you will join us later via Facebook or YouTube. We pray again that you will have an encounter with Jesus during this worship service. We will have Miss Robin now with the Children's Church message.
Good morning. How are y'all doing? Look at this great group of kids this morning. How many did it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 of you. It's good to see. Oh, goodness, 11, 12, 13. Nice to see y'all. Huh? Oh. Okay, so what do y'all think faith means? What do you think? Love it. Yes, you have trust in people. So it's like complete trust or confidence, right? In something or someone. Very good, honey. So we're going to do a little experiment. And I think, Braylon, you're going to help us. Come on. You already said you would. Don't back out now. Don't you back out now. All right, come on. So Braylon is going to do some things with me as far as follow some prompts, but guess what? He's going to have on a face mask, a blindfold. Yeah, it's a face mask, but I'm going to use it as a blindfold. He didn't know this, so now he's probably thinking, oh, I wish I hadn't agreed to do this. Can you see anything? No. Okay. All right. So I'm going to ask you to do some things, and I just want you to do what I ask, okay? You trust me? Okay. All right. So I want you to walk just 3 steps to your right. Now I want you to walk 20 steps forward. Okay, you can stop. All right. Now turn to your left. Very good. Maybe 3 steps. Okay. Now turn back to your right. Right there. Whoop, a little bit. Go back to your left. 1 step. Right there. Okay. Now go forward about 10 steps. Whew. Okay. Now I want you to turn around so you can hear my voice. Turn around to my voice. Right there. Good. Now walk back to me. Okay. Come on. Come on. Very good. Okay. Okay, right there, stop. Okay, now I want you to just turn a couple steps, good. Back up maybe just a couple of steps. Whoa. Okay. Now I want you to sit down. Oh, no. Okay. Can you stand up again? Okay. Now I want you to sit back in this chair. Very good. Yay. Thank you, Braylon. Wonderful job. Wonderful. Okay. He did just what I said, didn't he? I said, sit down. He didn't know what there was a chair there, did you? That's very good. Okay, so Braylon, how comfortable did you feel walking without being able to see? Scary. Yeah, it does feel scary, doesn't it? How comfortable did you feel that I was giving you good instructions and I wouldn't make you run into something? Did you feel, huh? Comfortable? Okay, good. So let me ask you all, isn't that something that we do every day when we think about God's direction for us? Right? So we're not always sure where God is taking us, are we? But we know that we listen to Him and we have faith that He is guiding us in the right direction, right? He's not going to let us stumble. If we do, He's going to make sure, just like when Braylon sat on the floor, He's going to make sure that He picks us right back up, okay? So I just want you to think about that. We don't always know, and you think about in the Bible when we're given commandments to follow, you know, we don't know exactly, we can't see God, we can't hear Him telling us that necessarily, but if we follow Him, we're going to go down the right path, okay? We have faith. So faith is being able to see, not being able to see, but trusting the one who can, all right? Everybody agree? Okay, so faith. All right, does anyone want to pray today? Chloe, you feel like praying? Okay, come on. Is there anyone we should pray for? Anyone have any prayer request? What do you think, Layla? Who's? She has? Aunt KK? Oh, she will Monday. Okay, wonderful. We will be praying for her and the baby. Good. Anyone else? All right.
God, Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone came to church today. And I hope Olivia comes to church again and her sister Allie and I hope they have a good trip to the church again. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Chloe. Okay. Here comes Miss Esther, and she's going to take y'all to Children's Church. Have fun.
Thank you, Robin, for the Children's Church message. My takeaway from Braylon, when God speaks to us, it needs to be immediate obedience. When Robin told him to sit down, he just sat right down, and that's the way God wants us to respond to Him. So now we're going to take time for prayers of the church. We always take the time to listen to prayer concerns, to thank God for answered prayers, and to just stress the importance of intercessory prayer. For those of you who have unspoken prayer requests, you will have a time to stand in the gap for that person or that situation. God already knows what's going on, and He will answer that prayer. Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I have asked Drew, is she here? Okay. To pray over our praise reports and prayer requests. And if you didn't get a chance to write any down, are there any additional praise reports or prayer requests?
Lisa, I know it's been said a bunch of times before, but I thank God that Laura and Robin
Any other praise reports or prayer concerns? And as Drew starts to pray, if you have an unspoken prayer request, please stand in the gap for that person this morning.
We have Earl Herndon, Marion Herndon, Ron Bengoin, Rose Howard, and Rose is doing much better, which is a praise report. David and Anne Marie Hodges. David had an ablation done this week, so if we could remember them. The Unsaved, the Standing Rock Reservation, our parents, students, and teachers, Amy Grubbs, Gaynell Grubbs, Mr. Leroy, what's this? Mike Simmons, Leroy Grubbs and family, Leroy's co-workers, thank God for his never-ending provisions, for his strength, his providing and uplifting. Thank God for our church and this county. Morgan Griffith, cancer patients, Edmund Christian Jr., Becky Armstrong, she has stage 4 cancer. And her brother, Mr. Bill, is so faithful to ask for prayer for her. Maya Richardson, Cheryl and Seth Ragland, John Jefferson, Gerald Atkins, the Vaya family, Norma Holmes. Norma's had a bug this week, but I think she's feeling much better. Miss Kathy, we're thankful for Laura and Robin and all they're doing for our children. And we're so thankful for Aunt Helene and that she could be here, and we pray that her legs will continue to be strengthened. Let us pray. Our Father, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for your goodness. You're such a good God. We lift up these folks on this prayer list. They all have a different need, but you know their need. We know that you're the great physician. We know that there's not a thing that you cannot do. And for the praise reports, we know that you have been in the midst of that as well. I would also remember those that are on our bulletin. We have a pretty long list on our bulletin as well. Some are sick, some are recovering, some are having to go into the hospital, some are just coming out of the hospital. For those that are going into the hospital, Father, I pray the doctors will prepare themselves, but I ask that you're in the midst of that preparation, that they will see clearly through your eyes what needs to be done, that they will let you guide their hands as they will work on these folks, operate, administer tests, whatever the situation is. We just thank you for being such an awesome God. You're so good to us, Father. You even give me a string when I need to tie something. You're just so good to me. I thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace, and we love you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Ms. Drew. Does anyone have a testimony this morning? Where have you seen God at work this week?
Good morning. Not so much a testimony, I guess it could be, but just I can't reiterate enough a challenge. Seeing some things happening. And our Sunday school lessons the last several weeks, talking about recognizing God's hands and things. Again, we got this long prayer request list. I challenge you to start tempering those prayer requests with praise reports. When you start recognizing everything that God's doing and you start recognizing God's hand in everything that you're doing, good, bad, or indifferent, then it changes your perspective. It doesn't change God's, it changes your perspective. Okay, so if we can recognize his hand in things, that can't be a bad thing for us. That's only going to propel us to do better things in his name. We talked about this morning in our Sunday school lesson, we're kind of backwards. When things go our way, Oh, we did a good job. I worked so hard for this. But who's the first person we blame when they don't go our way? You may not say it's your fault, but you ask God why. When we begin to temper our prayer requests with praise reports, that's when that perspective will change. We'll recognize that even though some things might not have gone our way, God's hand was still in it, and his hands are still working on it. So my challenge, like Darren often does, I challenge you, temper the prayer requests. He wants to hear them. I'm not saying, hey, list all the prayer requests you have. But also put some thought, some sincerity, some heartfelt sincerity in the things that he's doing for you and give him praise.
Thank you for sharing, Leroy. Miss Aline. Thank you, Miss Aline. At this time, we're going to be blessed by a musical selection from the Bradby family.
Pray that the good Lord will bless us getting organized.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Tomorrow would have been Mama Nita's birthday. And for those of you who remember her, know that music was a very important part of her life. So we would like to sing this morning in her memory, Medals for Mothers. Dream Mama walked up the heavenly stairs, and medals for mothers were mentioned up there. They mentioned a million things Mom did for me, things I took. Was pinned on her
By the way, was there with us physically. Her birthday tomorrow would be, she'd be 114 years old.
Thank you, Bradbury family. Leroy has already issued the challenge for us about praises. We are quick to ask God for stuff, and we need to be just as quick to thank him. For prayers already answered. We're going to have a praise song today. It's Lamb of God. But I want to talk about what happens when we praise God. This is based on Psalms 150. It's taken from Charles Stanley's Life Principles Bible. What happens when we praise God? Praise magnifies God. Praise puts our focus on God, not on our problems. Praise humbles us. When we worship God, we gain a right view of ourselves. Praise reveals our devotion to God. If I love Christ, I will praise him. If he has first place in my life, I will honor him with worship and thanksgiving. Praise motivates us to holy living. The more we worship him, the more like him we will become. Praise increases our joy. Joy is the constant companion of praise. If we feel depressed or discouraged, praising God will soon bring us joy. Praise establishes our faith. The greater we see our God, the smaller we see our problems. Praise elevates our emotions. Worry, fear, and doubt cannot survive for long in an atmosphere of praise. If you want to see a difference in your relationship with Christ and in your walk with him, start to praise him today. Our praise song is Lamb of God. Please stand if you are able. Please pray for Pastor Jay as he brings us today's message.
Thank you, Lisa, so much, and everybody else that's participated. It's been nice so far. I appreciate that so much. Let's see. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and you're going to be in for a treat because Brother Chief Steve Atkins is going to be preaching to you next Sunday. I'll be at the Richmond Racetrack with the Association, the Dover Association, and I'll be serving as a chaplain during that time for the people that are there. So anyway, be in prayer about that, if you would, but be in prayer for my brother as well as he comes, and invite somebody to come and hear him, okay? All right. And thank you so much for your presence here today. Turn in your Bibles to Luke's Gospel. We're going to look at one verse today, verse 46. Luke 23, verse 46. Please stand, if you will, for God's word. Dr. Luke writes, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. Our Heavenly Father, we can never thank you enough for the gift of your Son and the privilege, the honor that you have given to so many of us and will give to anyone who calls upon your name, Lord, to know his wondrous love. And so, Father, we pray through the power of your Holy Spirit that you will speak to our minds and hearts here today, and that you will be lifted up above all else, and you'll have the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please be seated. This is the last of the seven sayings of Jesus from the cross, and I thank you for sitting through the first six with me. Jesus here in this seventh saying is saying a prayer of faith, confidence, and love. Though Dr. Luke is aware of the other six sayings, he wanted his readers to focus on this final prayer. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Actually, this was a traditional evening prayer pious Jews would pray before they went to sleep. Something similar to a child's prayer. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. But of course, this prayer went much deeper. During the last 3 hours of Jesus' time on the cross, the Father had withdrawn from the Son, and Jesus cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? But now it is finished. The cup of suffering is over. The storm has passed. The darkness has ended. The fellowship, the communion that was broken for 3 hours in all of eternity was back in place, never to be broken again. And Jesus cries out loudly, Father! How often had the words, Father, been on the lips of Jesus? We first hear him say it as a boy of 12. His family had gone to Jerusalem to celebrate
Passover. And after Passover was over and they were headed back home, they didn't realize that Jesus wasn't with them until they were well into their journey. After a three-day search, they finally found him in the temple conversing with the teachers who, by the way, were amazed at his wisdom. Upon finding him, his mother asked, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." To which he replied, "Why were you searching for me? Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" The first time that we hear him speak in the scriptures, he calls God his father. And here in our text, in his last earthly words as a man, once again, he calls God his father. Certainly, this is a prayer of faith. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Jesus chooses to pray this prayer at the moment he enters into the ultimate sleep. As he lived, so he would die, with God's word in his heart, on his mind, and from his lips. Turn in your Bibles or your devices to Psalm 31. Psalm 31. And follow along as I begin reading it at verse 2. David is the writer of the psalm, and in it he says, "Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God." Why is David asking God to do something that he knows God is already doing? Why is David asking God to be his refuge, to be his strength, to be his deliverer? Isn't God already those things to David? David is claiming what he already knows personally about God. The great preacher of the 19th century, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, said, "We should pray to enjoy and experience what we grasp by faith." Let me repeat that. We should pray to enjoy and experience what we grasp by faith. That is, we need to pray with our hearts what we know in our minds to be true. That's what David was doing. What about you? What about you? When you pray, do you truly believe that God is your refuge, your strength, and ever-present help in times of trouble? When life seems to be going all wrong, which is quite often for me at least, and everything seems to be upside down, is Jesus still for you the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by him? Is he still that God? Do you still believe that God works all things together for good to them who love him, to them who are called according to his purposes? Like David, we pray to God to be our refuge, our strength, our provider, our deliverer, because in our heart of hearts, we know that's what he is. And that's a prayer of faith. And a prayer like that is never more crucial than at the moment of death. For without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. In Psalm 31, David entrusts his spirit to God because David is convinced that God is able to continue life even after his body dies. And just before Jesus breathes his last, he prays in faith, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Last Sunday I spoke to you, at least in part, about how no one takes the life of Jesus. He lays it down voluntarily. Jesus had given himself into the hands of sinners to be crucified. Now, he voluntarily delivers his spirit into the hands of the Father. Never again would he be in the hands of men. Never again would he be at the mercy of the wicked, of which there was no mercy. And never again would he suffer shame. In 3 days, he would be raised from the dead. 40 days after that, he would be exalted to the right hand of the Father, high above all rulers, all authorities, all principalities, all powers, where one day every knee will bow of things in heaven and things on earth and things under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father, where the earth will be made his footstool, and he will return just as he promised, but this time things will be different. Once he was in their hands, but in that day they will be in his. Once they cried, "Away with him! Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!" But in that day, he will say, "Depart from me. I never knew you. Away from me, you doers of evil." So here, in a loud prayer of faith, Jesus shouts, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Yet this is not only a prayer of faith, but it is certainly a prayer of confidence, a prayer of confidence. Some may ask, "Pastor, what's the difference between faith and confidence?" And the difference is this: faith is a gift from God. Faith is not anything that we can muster up on our own. It's a gift from God.
God gives us the faith to have faith. To have faith to strengthen our resolve and to trust in his word and to follow the leading of his spirit. Confidence, on the other hand, is a human attribute based on our past experiences, knowing that God is who he says he is and he will do what he says he will do. When Lazarus, the brother of Martha and Mary, was sick, the sisters sent word to Jesus in hopes that Jesus would hurry and come and heal their brother. But Jesus didn't even show up until Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. However, 4 days earlier, Jesus had said to his disciples, "This sickness," that is Lazarus's sickness, "will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory." Jesus did not come into this world to do the will of people, even people that he loves and cares for. Jesus came into this world to do the will
of his Father, and in so doing, give God the glory that Jesus was confident the Father should have. Often we read in the scriptures that Jesus would go to a solitary place where he would pray. In his humanness, that is where he was gathering confidence to face whatever lay ahead in the day before him. If that was our Lord's habit, don't you think it ought to be your habit and mine as well? Let me ask you this. In his very last hours before he was arrested, where was he? And what was he doing? He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And there he was sweating great drops of blood, gathering the confidence to pray, "Not my will, but yours be done." I know I've said this before, but Jesus did not want to go to the cross. He did not want to face the horror. He did not want to face the pain, the suffering that he knew awaited him there. And yet, in confidence, he prays, "Father, not my will, but yours be done." For those of us who have committed our lives and faith to Christ, it's so important that, as the Apostle Peter tells us, we must follow in confidence in his steps. We must heed Jesus' invitation to all of us when he says, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls." As Jesus lived, so he would die, yielding himself confidently into the hands of the Father, which we can see from the text in his earthly life was the very last thing that he did. It shows the intimacy between the Father and Son. It shows Jesus' dependence on the Father, and it shows his perfect confidence in his Father. And so he prays in confidence, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Those of you who are sitting here today, and by the way, I'm very glad that you're here, and those that are watching on Facebook or YouTube or out in the parking lot, I'm glad that you're watching or listening as well. But have you done that? Have you done that? Have you committed your spirit in confidence into the hands of the Father? Can you say in confidence with the Apostle Paul, "I know in whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day"? Have you heeded Paul's words when he says to the church at Rome, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Are you confident to let this mind,
to let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death upon the cross. Are you living in full confidence of God's of the God who loved you? And while we were yet sinners, sent his Son to die in our place. Are you confident knowing that without him, you can do nothing, but with him, all things are possible? Are you confident that with him, you can do all things to make you strong? Let me tell you, when you are confident in the faith that God gives you, and all that he has already done for you in life, then like Jesus, when death comes, it'll just be completely natural for you to say in confidence, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. In the Old Testament book of Numbers, the prophet Balaam said, let me die the death of the righteous, and may my final end be like theirs. Listen, this is important. To die like the righteous, you must live like the righteous. Amen? And living like the righteous consists of having an unwavering faith in God, an unwavering confidence that God is who he says he is, and he will do what he says he will do. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Certainly, this is a prayer of faith and confidence, and most assuredly, it is a prayer of love. It is a prayer of love. With Jesus praying it, how could it be anything less? The text tells us that after Jesus prayed this prayer, he breathed his last. Everything about Jesus was completely unique. His birth, his life, his death, everything. But very specifically, his death was different from all other deaths, for his death was an act of his will. He lays his life down, yet Jesus did not live, nor did he die for himself. No, he lived and died in accordance to the Father's will, knowing that it's not God's will that anyone should perish, but that all should come to repentance. For God so loved you, for God so loved me, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The Father's hands are the very place of eternal security, and it is into those hands that Jesus not only commits his spirit, but all who belong to him through faith. Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10, or your devices, turn to John chapter 10, and follow along as I begin at verse 27. This is Jesus speaking. He says, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. In that passage, when Jesus talks about sheep, is he talking about animals? Or is he talking about those who have turned away in repentance from their sins and turned in faith to follow him? Well, I'll give you a clue. He's not talking about animals. He's talking about those who turn away in repentance from their sins and turn in faith to follow him. Later in John's gospel, Jesus says, "My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friend." That's what Jesus has done for you and for me. But then he says this, "You are my friends," listen, "you are my friends if you do what I command." Let that sink in. At one point, in his frustration with his own disciples and their lack of understanding, he asked, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things that I say?" Are you his friend? Do you love Christ? Are you willing to lay down your life to follow him, to serve him, to see his kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven? Are you willing to deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow him? Because I'm pretty sure that's what it means to love him with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our strength and mind, and our neighbors as ourselves, to love one another as he loved us. Are you his friend? On the night before Jesus was crucified, the Apostle Peter had denied knowing Jesus three times. Days later, after Jesus had arisen from the grave, and on the shores of Galilee, Jesus asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" Each time, Peter answered, "Yes, Lord." And on the final time, he says, "Lord, you know I love you. You know all things." And Jesus responded to each one of those answers by saying, "Feed my lambs. Take care of my sheep, feed my sheep." In essence, Jesus was foretelling Peter of what James would later write when he penned, "Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works." A faith without works doesn't work. A faith without works is a dead faith, and a dead faith is no faith at all. On the cross, Jesus was surrounded by a taunting crowd. His agony is beyond full description, yet nevertheless, he's there dying for you. He's there dying for me, and at the same time, he is in full fellowship. He's in full communion with the Father. To be in fellowship, to be in communion with the God who loves us beyond our comprehension is really the greatest privilege and honor any of us can ever have or know. And listen to this, through faith in Jesus Christ, it's ours to have and to know, regardless of our circumstances in life, regardless of where we are, regardless of what's happening all around us. It was true for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the midst of the fiery furnace. It was true for Daniel in the lion's den. It was true for Paul and Silas in the Philippian jail. It was true for Jesus on the cross. And it will be true for all who have loved him as he has loved us. Are you his friend?
When we have love for Christ and one another, as Christ has loved us, we'll know exactly what the Apostle Paul was referring to when he asked the church at Rome rhetorically, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. When we love Christ, when we love one another like that, the world will beat a pathway to our doors, and the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it. David wrote, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. If that was true of David, who knew nothing of our Savior's life, his ministry, the miracles that he wrought, the suffering that he endured upon the cross, because it hadn't taken place, then why wouldn't it be true for those of us who have placed our faith in the work that Christ did on the cross on our behalf? Those of us who have confidence in who God says he is and what he has promised in his word. Those of us who know that just before Jesus ascended into heaven, he promised to be with us always, even unto the end of the age. Often when a person dies, family members, loved ones, take great care and sometimes at great expense to make sure that the body of the deceased is buried with dignity. And certainly that's proper, and there's nothing morally wrong in doing so. Yet my experience has been, before a person dies, they are much more concerned with their soul than they are with the disposal of their body. And that is the greater concern, isn't it? Isn't that why Jesus died on the cross, to give his life a ransom? Listen, Jesus never prayed, Father, into your hands I commit my body. He never prayed, Father, into your hands I commit my dust. No, he prayed in faith. He prayed in confidence, and he prayed in love, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Like last week's shout from the cross, it is finished, so here too, we hear another shout of victory. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't it true, for at least most of us, that on a daily basis we struggle to take care of ourselves in life? What would make any of us think that we would be able to do a better job in death? In life, the cards are pretty much stacked against us. We're needy. We need everything. We need air. We need water. We need shelter. We need food. You name it, we need it. We get injured. We get sick. We get old. On a daily basis, the world is out to kill us. But when we put our faith, our confidence, and our love in the work of Christ on the cross, when we put our spirit in the Father's hands, of whom no one can take us out, we are assured of safe harbor for all of eternity. In his final hour on the cross, Jesus does not falter in his faith, in his confidence, or in his love. And the Father stands ready to receive him as Jesus prays, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Into whose hands will you commit your spirit? Yourself? Good luck with that. A job? Money? Power? Prestige? Philosophy? I pray that, like Jesus, you will commit your spirit here and now, if you have never done so before, into the Father's hand. And when the time comes for you to cross over into eternity like Jesus, you'll know in faith, in confidence, and in love that the Father stands ready to receive you in his hands, and safe harbor will be assured. Safe harbor will be assured. Our Heavenly Father, we again can never thank you for what you sent your Son to do on our behalf. Help us to take in these words that you spoke from the cross and use them, God, to deal with us in whatever way that you would mold us, in whatever way that you would move us, in whatever way that you would use us to see your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. We do love you, Lord, and we thank you for loving us. If there's one here today that does not know you as his or her personal Lord and Savior, I pray through the power of your Holy Spirit's convicting power, God, that they will just sense your presence and sense that drawing that only the Holy Spirit can provide. And Father, if there are those here that are struggling through turmoil at home or at their job or whatever that need is, I don't know what it is, God, you do, and I know that you want to help those, but you expect us to reach out our hand to take yours. So help us, give us the faith, give us the confidence, give us the love to do just that. And may you have the glory for it. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. I'll ask my deacons to stand around the church. And if you feel led to pray with someone today, you've got a concern on your heart, they'll be here to greet you. I'll be standing up front. I don't know what your decisions are. God does. He wants you to step out in faith and be that person he's called you to be. So let's stand as we sing our hymn of invitation. Amen. Well, thanks again for coming today. And today, dismissing us will be Reggie Brown. So Reggie, if you would come, please.
Bow your heads. My King, my Father, Lord, just I ask you to be with us daily. Lord, just give us the faith to go into the world and make disciples of all nations in your name. Father God, Lord, just that it's not about us, but humble us before the cross daily. Lord, Father God, that it's not about us, remind us daily. And Lord, just be with us throughout this week. Let us take us lessons from the day and go to make disciples again for you and not about us. But give us the faith to follow you daily. In Jesus' prayer, amen.